The crew of a merchant ship, including two Filipinos, now safe after a botched hijack attempt off the coast of Yemen. U.S. Navy forces took into custody five pirates who boarded the MV Central Pork, which is owned by an Israeli businessman. Now, just recently, Houthi rebels hijacked an Israeli-linked cargo ship, the Galaxy Leader, with 25 crew members on board, including 17 Filipinos. Houthi rebels said they carried out the attack in retaliation for Israel's offensive against Palestinians. The Israeli government set to provide freed Filipino hostage Jimmy Pacheco lifetime social security benefits and regular stipends. The benefits are similar to those given to Israelis who are victims of terrorist attacks. Israeli Foreign Minister Eli Cohen personally visited Pacheco at a hospital where he's recovering after 49 days of captivity in Gaza. Pacheco is among those released by Hamas militants on the first day of the four-day truce. Meanwhile, a 60-year-old Filipino remains missing. The Philippine government believes Norlin Babadilla may have also been abducted by Hamas. A four-year-old Israeli-American girl was among those released from Hamas' captivity. Here's the full story.
Israeli-American toddler Abigail Eden was among 17 hostages that the militant group Hamas released Sunday.
Her mom was killed in front of her when her kibbutz was attacked by Hamas terrorists on October 7th. Abigail ran to her dad then, who then was gunned down as well, while using his body to shield little Abigail.
U.S. President Joe Biden shed light on the diplomatic efforts that have been at play to secure the Hamas-Israel temporary ceasefire.
We've been in close contact with the leaders of Qatar, Egypt, and Israel, speaking with each one of them repeatedly over the past few weeks to help secure this deal. The proof that this is working and worth pursuing further is in every smile and every grateful tear we see on the faces of those families who are finally getting back together again.
The road to recovery could be long, though.
Physically, many of them are doing okay. Emotionally and psychologically, this is going to take a long time to recover from. And Israel and other countries have mobilized substantial resources to be able to deal with that trauma as we go forward.
As part of the truce, dozens of Palestinian prisoners have also been freed, and fuel and humanitarian aid has been entering Gaza. But it's unclear if the ceasefire will hold or be extended.
When this ceasefire period ends, as Netanyahu has said, the conflict will continue. And that conflict will continue, as Israel has stated, until Hamas is removed.
There are hopes, however, that a permanent solution to the Israel-Hamas conflict can be eventually reached.
Until there is an independent Palestinian state, there is not going to be peace or security in that region.
From the Vatican, Pope Francis also underscored the importance of dialogue to resolve the conflict and celebrated the latest release of hostages. Veronica Valderas Iglesias, VOA News, Washington.
Militant group Hamas and Israel's war cabinet expressing willingness to extend their four-day truce. The Qatar-brokered ceasefire is set to expire today. Israel earlier said it would extend the truce by one more day for every 10 hostages that Hamas frees. The ceasefire has seen the release of three groups of Israeli hostages from war-torn Gaza and three groups of Palestinian prisoners from Israeli jails. Much-needed aid has also reached Gaza, where over 14,000 have died. U.S. President Joe Biden also expressed support for an extended pause in the fighting. In the U.S., police and federal agents in Vermont searching for a gunman who shot and wounded three college students of Palestinian descent in what investigators suspect was a hate-motivated crime. Two of the victims are U.S. citizens and the third is a legal U.S. resident. The victims were reported to have been speaking Arabic, and two of them were wearing traditional Middle Eastern scarves at the time of the attack. The shooting comes amid a rise in anti-Islamic and anti-Semitic incidents in the U.S. since the Israel-Hamas war erupted last month. Over now to the Russia-Ukraine front, Moscow launched its largest drone attack on Kyiv since the start of its invasion. More in this report.
An air raid siren blares amid a Russian drone attack on the Ukrainian capital. The head of the capital city administration, Serhii Popko, called it the most massive air attack by drones on Kyiv. Ukraine's Air Force said it shot down 74 of the 75 Iranian-made drones. The attack started Saturday, coming in waves for more than 6 hours and leaving 17,000 people without power in the region, according to Ukraine's energy ministry. It also came on the 90th anniversary of the Holodomor famine genocide. Holodomor, which means death by hunger or starvation, was a campaign through 1932 and 33 orchestrated by then-Soviet leader Joseph Stalin to seize control of Ukraine's grain production. At least 3.5 to 7 million Ukrainians died. According to the University of Minnesota, those numbers may be understated.
Caro Presidente Zelensky, caro Volodymyr.
It was against this backdrop that Italian Prime Minister Giorgia Meloni recorded a video message to Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky on Holodomor Memorial Day. She said her government welcomed Kyiv's resolve to continue the Grain from Ukraine humanitarian food program, announcing a further contribution of $2.2 million to the effort. As part of the program, Ukraine partnered with countries and private sector donors to supply its grain to countries in Africa and Asia that face malnutrition and hunger. At a recent meeting of the UN Security Council, Ukraine's permanent representative to the United Nations accused Moscow of again using similar tactics as those in the early 1930s.
Starvation is one of Russia's methods of warfare, has encompassed various components since day one of the full-scale invasion. These include blocking Ukrainian food exports, shelling Ukrainian ports and grain stores, mining Ukrainian fertile soils, and turning them into battlefields.
Following Russia's drone strikes, Zelensky and European leaders met in Kyiv at an international summit on food security. He said foreign partners would supply Ukraine with vessels to accompany and secure convoys of cargo ships from Ukraine's ports. Zelensky added his country hoped to solve air defense shortages through new supplies from partners and increasing Ukraine's own production capacity before another air raid siren cut short the joint news conference. At least 5 civilians in Kyiv were wounded in Russia's assault on the capital, with several buildings damaged from falling debris, including a kindergarten. Those injured include an 11-year-old child, according to Mayor Vitaly Klitschko. Arash Arabasadi, VOA News.
China, Japan, and South Korea agreed to restart cooperation, paving the way for a summit in the latest move to ease tensions between the Asian neighbors. The foreign ministers of the three countries met in the South Korean port of Busan Sunday. That's their first since 2019. The ministers agreed to advance cooperation in 6 areas, including security, economy, and technology. Chinese Foreign Minister Wang Yi also called for a restart to negotiations on a trilateral free trade agreement as soon as possible. The three officials did not specify a time frame for the summit, but the move comes as Japan and South Korea bolster their ties with the U.S. China's health ministry urges local authorities to increase the number of clinics amid the surge of respiratory illnesses. The development comes as China marks its first winter since it eased COVID restrictions. The spike became a global issue last week when the World Health Organization asked China for more information, citing a report on clusters of undiagnosed pneumonia in children. The WHO, meanwhile, says data provided by China suggested the recent cases were linked to the lifting of COVID curbs about a year ago. Well, here at home, an infectious diseases expert sounds the alarm over the situation in China. Dr. Ranjin Solante reminds the public to mask up and keep COVID and flu vaccinations up to date.
Hindi tayo magpapanik na baka sasabihin na naman natin another COVID or a novel pathogen, no, na hindi natin alam, no? But it's also important na while we are monitoring, mag-iingat din tayo dahil alam mo naman ang sakit ngayon, mabilis nang mag-travel between country to another country dahil nga sa wala nang restriction, no?
The Philippine Health Department earlier said it will keep tabs on the situation in China. It also advised Filipinos traveling to China to exercise minimum public health standards. Over in the U.S., the state of Oregon is trying a different approach to combat opioid abuse. More in this report.
JB lives on the streets of Oregon's biggest city. He's an active fentanyl user and says he has been abusing opiates for 20 years.
If it blackens up or like tastes really funky, it's not good stuff. I get really good stuff.
In a country struggling with an epidemic of fentanyl abuse, voters here approved decriminalizing small amounts of controlled substances in 2020. The goal was to destigmatize drug abuse and invest more in recovery. Instead of facing criminal charges, people caught with small amounts of hard drugs are given a citation and an opportunity for treatment. It's a plan modeled on Portugal's 2001 decision to decriminalize some hard drugs and boost treatment. But in Oregon, data collected since the program's start show few people following up with treatment. And those who do are faced with long waits, thanks to the state's historic underinvestment in behavioral health care. Tara Hurst heads an alliance of Oregon groups involved in the program.
What we've seen is when you don't have the services available and you don't have the care and the infrastructure and plans together when you're dealing with a crisis, it usually doesn't go well.
She says making the program a success depends on shifting people's views of addicts.
Do you see them as that they're making poor choices, or are you following the science that says this is a disease, this is something that can be treated, not cured, people do recover?
Launched during the coronavirus pandemic, the program known as Measure 110 has had uneven results, leading some to question its effectiveness. Max Williams is a former director of the Oregon Department of Corrections and a former state lawmaker.
Measure 110 was about meeting people where they were, meeting people who were dealing with substance abuse where they are. But Measure 110 has often left those people there. And we want to meet them where they are as well. We just don't want to leave them there.
Williams is part of a coalition backing a new referendum to recriminalize small amounts of hard drugs and make substance abuse treatment mandatory.
The whole idea here is not to ramp up additional charges on an individual, make a longer criminal history, or to use ineffectively jail resources. It's to create enough consequence along with reward to motivate this particularly difficult group of people dealing with addiction to actually seek treatment and recovery services.
David is a drug addict who also declined to share his last name. He says he has tried detoxing many times, but struggles to stay sober when he says Portland treatment centers are always short on space.
And there's just no beds available anywhere for inpatient, anything like that. You know, and when the staff tell you that, it's frustrating. It's very frustrating.
A 2021 federal survey ranked Oregon last in the nation for the availability of drug treatment facilities. Since the start of Measure 110 in 2020, the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention says opioid overdose deaths in Oregon have doubled. Deborah Bloom, VOA News, Portland, Oregon.